and exalted over all the peoples. Holy is God, lover of justice. You have established equity and righteousness in the name of Jacob. Let us exalt and worship God. God of majesty and might, thank you for this day. You have blessed us with revelation of your glory as this day dawns. You are all wisdom and a lamp to our feet, revealing new ways we may talk in your world and live according to your will. Give us the gift of faith that we may hear and discern your voices for ourselves. Thank you for the holy moment of transfiguration with Jesus. True identity was made plain. Show us anew the power of your glory through the light of your Son, who taught us to pray together, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. 6 days later, Jesus took with him Peter and James and his brother John and led them up a high mountain by themselves. And he was transfigured before them, and his face shone like the sun, and his clothes became dazzling white. Suddenly there appeared to them Moses and Elijah talking with him. Then Peter said to Jesus, "Lord, it is good for us to be here. If you wish, I will make three dwellings here, one for you, one for Moses, and one for Elijah." While he was still speaking, suddenly a bright cloud overshadowed them, and from the cloud a voice said, "This is my son, the beloved. With him I am well pleased. Listen to him." When the disciples heard this, they fell to the ground and were overcome by fear. But Jesus came and touched them, saying, "Get up and do not be afraid." And when they looked up, they saw no one except Jesus himself alone. As they were coming down the mountain, Jesus ordered them, "Tell no one about this vision until after the Son of Man has been raised from the dead." This is the word of God. Thanks be to God.
That's a concept that I've always had a hard time kind of figuring out, and so I figure I'm not the only one who has trouble with that concept of transfiguration. But you'll see the picture on your front cover of the bulletin with Jesus and Moses and Elijah, and then the disciples kind of looking at them. We don't see their faces, but I'm figuring that they have a look of awe on their face. And so today we're getting ready for the journey into Lent. Ash Wednesday is this Wednesday. So we're going to be following Jesus on his final journey into Jerusalem. And we need a little bit of context for today's lesson. And before the story for today, Jesus had told his disciples that he would undergo great suffering in Jerusalem and eventually be killed and raised on the third day. Well, when the disciples heard this, they didn't quite understand what he was talking about, and Peter was really very distraught by these words and said, "God forbid that that should happen." And that was when Jesus scolded him very harshly and said, "Satan, get behind me." Because I don't think this is what the disciples expected would happen to the man they recognize as the Son of God. They had met their Messiah, and he was gaining a lot of momentum in that brief period of time with his healings and his teachings. Jesus was getting quite a following. And surely, surely suffering and death in Jerusalem would not be the fate of a man like this. I'm sure that they had a hard time kind of accepting that and grasping that. So I can imagine them saying, "Oh, Jesus, don't be so melodramatic. You know, it's not going to be like that at all. No, don't say those things to scare us. You're frightening us. What are you doing, Jesus?" That's my thinking. You know, I mean, if I put myself there and I think that's what I would probably, how I'd probably be reacting. And so today's lesson happened 6 days later after he had had this conversation with them. And so here Jesus is taking Peter, James, and John up into the mountains. So we have another story that takes place in the mountains. In the last few weeks, we'd been hearing about the Sermon on the Mount, where he was preaching and teaching on a mountaintop. And so the mountaintop setting, as we know, is a place of great importance. And it's often the point where the divine and the human meet. They meet on the mountaintop. And we all have experiences like this ourselves. Moses encountered God and received the Ten Commandments on top of Mount Sinai. Elijah met God in a cave in Mount Horeb. And here these two guys show up again. So these two prophets played an important role in proclaiming God's reign and glory. And now Jesus is following in their footsteps. But first, he talked to his disciples about his impending death, and then 6 days later, he takes them up into the mountains. So can you imagine, after all that, I mean, there must be a lot of emotional kind of turmoil for them. Then they go up to the mountain top with Jesus, and then he shines bright as the sun before them, and his clothes are dazzling white. He's transformed before them, transfigured. And so I can imagine they're seeing this sight and thinking, what's happening? They knew Jesus as their teacher, a great prophet, the Messiah, and then he started talking about his suffering and death, and now here he is glowing like the sun. And then Moses and Elijah appear, and there they are with Jesus, talking with Jesus. And Peter, love Peter, he is moved by this sight, and so he's kind of surmised that this mountaintop here is a good place to be. I mean, look, these three, Moses and Elijah and Jesus, are there together. And so he wants to do something for them, build some dwellings for them, for all three of them, so that I'm guessing, we don't know for sure, but I'm guessing that perhaps he wanted to build a permanent place for them where they can find shelter. And maybe he's still so distraught by the words of Jesus that Jesus is going to suffer and die, that he wanted to shelter him, a place of safety. And maybe he was also, being Peter, maybe a little bit boastful and maybe a little bit needy. So I know sometimes we have these tendencies in us. I will make three dwelling places for you if you desire. I'm going to do this. No, not the three of us, the apostles there. I will do this for you. It's my idea. Let's just stay here. It's good that we're here. I can picture Peter going on and on about his grand building schemes and what a great idea he had, and then suddenly God interrupts him. This is my son, the beloved. Listen to him. Listen to him. Well, God was trying to prepare these guys for life when Jesus would no longer be physically present with them. And Jesus changed before them on that mountaintop. He's shining as brilliant as the sun, his clothes are dazzling white. Well, surely that's a sign that he is eternal, that he has gifts and blessings from beyond our human realm, from beyond our human realm. So there's no doubt with Jesus in that countenance, this brilliant countenance, that he is God's beloved son. It's definitely a sign that God is there and present in Jesus. And there's Peter going on talking about building shelters for these prophets, men of God who've transcended time and history. These are not ordinary men. Perhaps he thought that since Moses and Elijah had come to the mountaintop to be with Jesus, he could prevent Jesus' death, as if he could control things. Sometimes we think we can control things. In fact, we even sometimes feel like we can control what God, we could tell God what we want God to do. You know, pull a few strings here and there, right? As if he, Peter, had the capability to keep them safe and make them earthbound. Here, we're going to put you right here on this mountaintop. But we can't keep divine experiences, divine people earthbound in our tidy little buildings that we erect, even if we've had a remarkable mountaintop experience. And so God interrupts this scene of what I call project management construction and pulls them back to the main message at hand. Listen to him. Listen to him. You know, we do have this tendency to focus on our plant and building maintenance. And so I'm looking at this passage and saying, well, it goes way, way back. It's not just a problem we have today. It goes way back. But God says, listen to them. This is my beloved. And these three men fall down on the ground in fear and reverence. Okay, okay, God, got it. Focus. Jesus is the man. Listen to him. Listen to him. Okay, got it. And this is the part of the passage that I really love. Jesus came and touched them and said, get up and do not be afraid. Maybe it's because I'm a massage therapist that I like the fact that Jesus touched them and said, do not be afraid. He laid his hands on them. And I see those hands of Jesus as healing hands, reassuring hands, guiding hands, instructing them to get up and do not be afraid. And they listened to him, at least at that moment. Throughout his entire ministry, Jesus healed people through his touch. There are many accounts of his healing touch in the Gospels, as well as people who touched him, touched his garment in the hopes of finding healing. And here in this story, he touches his companions, and here I feel that he's healing them of their fear and their inertia to help them go back down the mountain and face the future. They needed his touch to help them make their way back down. Peter wanted to somehow enshrine and protect this magnificent experience that they had on the mountaintop, perhaps protect Jesus from his eventual suffering and death that he had been talking about. But as is often the case with Peter, he got it all wrong. Well, have you ever had a powerful experience that you wish it would never end, just never end? Something as simple as a good movie or a good book that caused you to just buzz about it afterwards, long afterwards. So you wish it would just continue, the story would continue. And I guess that's why we have sequels and series that go on, and this is why people make a lot of money, because they know, you know, producing yet another epic sequel, and they know we'll all go rushing because we don't want that experience to end. Sometimes when I go on retreat, I go away to a nice quiet place, sit in my little room, go out into the meadows where the retreat place is. I don't want to come home. I think, how great would it be to live the life of a monk? Just stay in my quiet little place, preferably a scenic, quiet location where I can focus on God, not worry about all that other stuff going on in life. I would love that, just have it go on. But then we have to get back to our reality, our routines, our usual routines, because God needs us there in our routines. Jesus said, get up and do not be afraid, and then he takes us down the mountain. Then we get back into our routines, right after an experience, great experience, and ponder what it was that we just experienced. It takes time sometimes to process all that. Like that good movie, what does it mean for us? A life-changing event that still reverberates. Or when we come to church on Sunday, here, this is a great moment that we're together with fellowship, finding spiritual nurture and worship. And then we have to plunge back in to our week. We leave this place having seen our friends, having sung some beautiful hymns, having focused on God. And we hope that this will carry us through, don't we? We hope that this will carry us through the week. Well, God basically told the disciples up on the mountaintop to just quit fussing around setting up camp and building dwellings, trying there to settle in. Just listen to Jesus. Those fellows had a lot to learn, and we're probably still processing what happened to them on that mountaintop. Jesus still had a lot to teach them. He had a lot to do to prepare them so that they can continue the work that he started long after he's gone. So they couldn't be hanging around on that mountaintop forever. They had to come back down. They had to plunge back into life. I just read an account by Nadia Boltz-Weber, who is this sort of, I've mentioned her before in a sermon. She is a kind of a progressive Lutheran pastor covered with tattoos from head to toe, and she rides a motorcycle, and she's a recovering alcoholic and has really, I mean, she's seen life to the hilt. Well, she was on vacation with her husband and some friends, enjoying the good life, having a great probably a mountaintop experience herself. And then through an email, she said she was sorry she was checking her emails while she was, you know, on vacation, but she did. And then she found out that a colleague of hers had struck a woman while he was driving while intoxicated, which is not a smart thing to do. Voice texting while he was driving, struck a woman and killed her. And so she found out that her colleague was in prison. Oh, and he himself had just lost his wife to cancer. His wife, they'd been married, I think, at that point, probably close to 30 years. And here he was sitting in prison and eventually got a 10-year sentence. So lives were shattered all the way around. This is the kind of pain we encounter when we come down from the mountain and when we plunge back into life. How many times do we wish that we can undo something or rewrite the past? I know I have those moments, but we can't. So we're basically kind of messed up people in a messed up world. You know, sometimes we get it right, but sometimes we don't. And then we go to the mountaintop, have this blessed, wonderful experience, but Jesus says, get up, do not be afraid, and let's go back down. It's the messiness of our world where we really begin to appreciate the radiance of Jesus. Right there in the moment, we're dazzled by it. But when we're back in the fray, then I think we can really appreciate what that means. So this morning, which I probably shouldn't do. I should probably just eat my breakfast and enjoy it. But I sit down and start to read the newspaper and all that. And I thought, geez, I wish I could just rewrite my whole sermon after what I've read. because I thought, on the radio, I heard about our opioid epidemic in this country is really becoming a huge crisis, and so many families now are affected by this. This is one of those, the messiness of our lives. And they said on the news that in 2015, 50,000 people died of an overdose. That's a lot, that is a lot of people, 50,000. And how do we, as a nation, deal with this? How do we, as compassionate people, work with this so that we can ease all of this? And I do believe, I didn't hear in the report, but I do believe that a lot of this is tied in with some of the other issues that people are facing, which leads me to the other article I was reading in the New York Times about how the new working class doesn't necessarily fit our ideas of what the working class is. It's changing. And people in the working class are having a hard time. Some of us, a number of us, know that firsthand. And jobs are disappearing. The world is changing. So I think about how one job that I had that no longer exists, I was a switchboard operator. Do we have any other switchboard operators in here, former? Yeah. I'm so old, I remember when we used to pull the plugs out and connect them, and then the people would call in, and then you'd say, they say, I like to call blah, blah, blah number, and I dial it for them and, you know, stick that cord in, and then our switchboard where I worked closed at midnight. So at midnight, I'd interrupt everyone's phone call and say, we're closing down, and I'd pull all the plugs out. I do remember that, and I'm thinking, who does that now, right? I mean, that job is long gone. Long gone with the buggy whip. So, you know, jobs as we know it change, and sometimes it's really hard to keep up. We talk about retooling. Well, easier said than done. You know, I still don't know how to turn on a new television. My husband, if I decide I want to watch TV, he comes over and he has to turn it on for me. I hate to admit that, but I still haven't figured out the remote control device. Because the last TV I bought, you pulled the on-off button out. That was in 1975. So some of us have a hard time keeping up. And it really is, it's tough. It's just tough. Well, now I'm reading in the New York Times Magazine that Budweiser just successfully tested a self-driving truck that is able to deliver beer 120 miles with no driver. Someone's job is disappearing there, right? Can you imagine a self-driving truck that has a range of 120 miles? And they successfully tested that. Amazon just opened up a store with no cashiers. You go in, you make your purchases, and there's no one to ring you out. It's all done automatically. Bank of America now opens branches with one staff person. One staff person. That's all they need. Lots of video terminals and ATM machines. The world is changing. And people, when they go shopping now, they don't necessarily go to a store, right? They're in their PJs in bed shopping. I mean, we shop differently now. So we have all these challenges in turmoil, disruption. Sometimes we just want to freeze things. Maybe go with Peter and tell him, yeah, build me that house, you know, on the mountaintop, and I'll just stay there and spend the rest of my life cozy and happy, not deal with all this. But we can't do that, can we? So, Ash Wednesday is this week, and we'll be making our way towards Jerusalem with Jesus into the messiness, into the fray, recalling our human frailty, and knowing about the suffering that he will be enduring. But we have the presence of God with us. That radiance of Jesus will stay with us, reminding us to pay attention to Jesus. And as God says, listen to him. Listen to him. Jesus, who reassures us with his healing touch, his reassuring touch, and his guiding touch. And his words, do not be afraid. Do not be afraid. We'll go down that mountain together. Amen.
Thank you.
So I just had another thought as we gather together for prayer. One of the ways that we can, as we come down the mountaintop with Jesus, we also can share his healing touch and be Jesus for one another, because we do need that. Let us pray. Holy God, you revealed your love and guidance for us with Moses on Mount Sinai and Jesus on the Mount of Transfiguration, giving us a vision of how to live in this world, trusting in you. We know we don't always see and understand your ways, but we trust that you continue to abide with us and guide us. We pray for your church, that it may be the light of love for all people. We pray for all the nations of the world, that in times of turmoil, they may still govern with wisdom and care for the well-being of everyone. We pray for those who suffer illness or oppression, that our care for them may bring your healing and your liberation. We pray for your creation, that we may be wise and obedient stewards, that future generations may live in security. We pray for all those who are seeking you, that they may walk by the lamp of your spirit and find the peace, love, compassion, and wisdom as only you can provide. And we pray for those named in our bulletin today. We name out loud and silently those cares and concerns, those whom we love and lift up to you, knowing that you are always with us. Bonnie and Stephen Bates. Help us, O God, to hear the voice of Jesus. Help us to see his radiance that reflects your goodness. Even though we may leave many things undone, may your spirit continue to guide us as we walk through your world today. Joined together in Christ and in the unity of the Holy Spirit, we pray to you in Jesus' name, amen. And Jesus said, for where your treasure is, there your heart will be also. Let us now offer to God the gifts of our tithes and offerings. Let us pray. Our gracious and giving God, we thank you so much that Jesus can be revealed to us in all his radiance, reflecting your love for the world. We ask that you accept these offerings, that they may be used to further your work and your realm in our time and in all eternity and in the days to come. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Let us join hands for our benediction. For you shall go out in joy and be led forth in peace. The mountains and the hills before you shall break forth into singing, and all the trees of the field shall clap their hands. Instead of the thorn shall come up the cypress, and instead of the briar shall come up the myrtle, and it shall be to God a memorial, an everlasting sign that shall never be cut off. Go in peace, knowing that Christ is always with you. Amen.